this morning. Amen. God bless you. You got sound here, guys. Sound here, somebody. Sound here. All right. Let's turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 2. Amen. Good morning. A little bit of a dreary day outside, rainy. Amen. But the light of the gospel, let it shine this morning in our hearts. Is that your desire? Amen. Let's just look at 2 Corinthians chapter 2. I've got a PowerPoint. You just have that ready, Brother Josh. 2 Corinthians chapter 2. I'm just going to title this Sunday school, Satan's Devices. And we're just going to keep it and sort of stay in a line of thought. This is verse 11 of 2 Corinthians chapter 2. Lest Satan should get an advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. You can be seated this morning. In order that Satan might not outwit us, that is the word for advantage in one translation. In order that Satan should not outwit us, for we are not unaware of his schemes. It's another word there that Paul uses. Would the word devices could be defined as his schemes. I think of the quote where Brother Branham says that overcoming is recognizing the devil in his tactics. So we understand that Satan hates church. Satan hates a body of believers locally that collect, that gather. He hates that type of gathering. Brother Branham said he would try to, he says, now you're a nice, sweet body of believers right now. And he said, you love one another. And he says, but Satan won't let it stay that way. He'll try to get in and sow discord or try to get some kind of inwards or fighting or something happening to try to break you up. And then that was his goal. That was his purpose. I'm titling this Satan's Devices, because Satan has schemes so that we would not be outwitted. That's another word rather than advantage, so that we would not be outwitted by Satan, for we are not ignorant of his designs. So I like those three words there. He has devices, he has schemes, and he has designs. Now, we took an entire series, maybe not a series, at least one or two parts. I preached a message on dimensional discernment, and I talked a lot about these devices. And we know that that could definitely be, it's not a stretch to say that you could apply that 2 Corinthians 2 to modern technology. We know Brother Branham spent a lot of time and spoke about the fourth dimension, and he talked about that dimension of radio and television and TV and radio waves, and how that spiritual warfare takes place in that dimension, not one that you can see, not one that that you can hear necessarily with your ears, but there's a dimension where there's demonic and angelic beings warring to get to your soul. Now, Brother Branham says you're caught in between of those two influences, right? You remember this? You're caught in between those two influences, to where you're being influenced from beneath by demonic powers, or you're influenced from above by angelic powers. The prophet of God would go further and say that when he was a little boy, he says, I started serving the Lord, and he says, and I gave my heart to the Lord. And he says, now I should have given my heart to the Lord years before I did, but something prevented me from doing that. And he said, a spirit hung over me to hold me back from surrendering to the Lord. Now, isn't that just a little incredible insight to that fourth dimension, that the prophet would say, I would have started serving the Lord before, but a spirit hung over my life. Now, so that, what does that tell you? That tells you that there's always the spirit of the devil in your life trying to hinder you or prevent you from receiving influence from above. Amen. It's there when you're born. It's there when you're born again. Amen. It's there when you're young. It's there when you're old. The prophet looks at his life and he says, I would have given my life to the Lord years before, but a spirit hung over me. Now that gives you some insight, young people, right? Yes. And now Brother Branham answers in questions and answers, and he says, do you believe in guardian angels? And is it a myth, or is that a fairy tale to believe in guardian angels? And the prophet says, no, absolutely, it's biblical. The Bible teaches that the Lord surrounds those, encircles those who fear him.
You remember in the Bible, it talks about the David refers over and over in the Old Testament, the Lord is called the Lord of hosts. Remember? He's called the Lord of hosts. So that word, if you translate the Lord of hosts, you literally get the English title of God, the Lord of, or let me back up. If you translate the Lord of hosts and you read that, David speaks of it, oh, thou mighty Lord of hosts, mighty in battle. You remember the scripture with Elijah where the man's eyes are blind and he can't see the armies that are there surrounding. He sees the number of enemies. Physically, he sees them with his eyes. And the prophet prays and said, Lord, open his eyes. His eyes were already open. He's already seeing. So he's talking about a spiritual insight. And he says, Lord, open his eyes, for they that be with us are more than they with them. So if you take that word, Lord of hosts, and you translate it, it's pretty powerful. The Lord of hosts is translated exactly in English, the God of angel armies. The Lord of hosts, the God of angel armies. So we just spent a little bit of time to preach on that, to teach that, the God of angel armies. It's pretty incredible when you think of that in that context or that light, when you say, oh, Lord of hosts, be with us. You're saying God who has angel armies that are surrounding me that'll fight for me. And that's spiritual warfare. A little bit of spiritual warfare. So in order that Satan might not outwit us, so that we should not, this is the 2 Corinthians King James Version, lest Satan should get an advantage on us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. Right. We are not ignorant of his schemes. We're not ignorant of his designs, his plans in that other dimension. And the prophet says, he says, you're a nice group of body of believers right now. And he says, you love one another. And Brother Branham begins to tell us, and he admonishes us, you've got to maintain the unity within the local body. You've got to maintain the sovereignty of the local body. You've got to maintain the atmosphere of love and brotherhood. This is something you don't ever see leave the ministry of Brother Branham, ever. All the way from 47 to 65, you'll hear Brother Branham in harvest time, and he's way after the seals, and he's imploring, he's preaching against denominations because they build barriers, they draw fences, they draw circles, and he says, and they tear down the brotherhood. Yeah, exactly. So this is something that the prophet, I don't care where he got in churches cutting him off and closing the doors and walking away from them, he always preached brotherhood, always. You're not preaching the message if you're not preaching unity and brotherhood amongst believers. Amen. If you're preaching discord and division, you're not preaching the message no matter how much we think we are. Listen to what Brother Branham says here, and I'm just going to pause and get this because we're preaching on Satan's devices. Let's look at the first slide there, if you could, Brother Josh. Just go ahead and pull that up, and I should be able to control it from right here. Just display that. If someone could turn on that monitor back there so I don't have to turn, and this one's off also. Listen to what Brother Branham says in Enticing Spirits. I have it here also. And he says, now another thing that has taken place, I believe, now I want to mute this just for a second to get you right where I'm at. I want you to notice we're preaching on Satan's schemes, his devices, his plans. He will use anything, and in fact, the things that he will use to bring destruction, disharmony, to throw things out of sync within a family, within a church, within a body of believers are usually not the weapons you would think he would use. But he uses things that are in plain sight, hidden in plain sight, that maybe you would be blind to. Maybe we call it a blind sight. And so Brother Branham talks about this, and he's speaking about the Pentecostal church, and he starts speaking about the and this is in the message, Enticing Spirits, incredible message. If you haven't heard it, in 1955, I believe it's July, it's just awesome. That message in July, he preaches on Enticing Spirits. It's just, I'd recommend, highly recommended you make that part of your listening this week. It's just wonderful. And he speaks about enticing spirits, and watch what he starts saying about the church. And he says, now another thing that has taken place, I believe and think that any man that's got an experience with God or a woman is bound to get a little emotional. Can this church say amen to that? I just believe it. This is something you won't find leaving Brother Branham's ministry. Pre-seals, post-seals, all the way to the end of his ministry, he preaches that when there's the Lord is it moves by emotion, that there's the emotion. Listen, let him say it this way. And he says, or a woman is bound to get a little emotional. I just believe it. That's right. But you know what? They've adopted emotionalism for the baptism of the Holy Ghost.
Yes, amen.
Now this is remember what we're preaching on, Satan's devices. Yeah. So what does he use to disrupt the church, to break up brotherhood, to destroy unity? He doesn't use the weapons that you would maybe think, but he's using something that Brother Branham says is true, a genuine, something that's real, emotion. And he says, but now they've taken it from the middle of the road and they've went to the right-handed ditch and they're in the ditch over here. Amen. They've adopted emotionalism for the baptism of the Holy Ghost. They just get a lot of noise and there's nothing in it. So you mean there could be a lot of noise and that's not true Holy Ghost emotion?
Amen.
It's true.
Amen.
Can I get a good amen?
Amen.
You live just as holy as you live noisy, then you'll be all right. Emotions is certainly all right. Bodily exercise profiteth little. But enticing spirits has gotten into the holiness group of people, and they've got them to just resting upon because they can shout, or because they can dance, because they can make emotion. So just because we can be emotional, don't mean that we're saved.
Amen.
Because we go to church, don't mean we're saved.
Amen. Amen.
Brother Luther, I love your amens, but I'd like some more out of the body here. Everybody agreeing with the word?
Amen.
Don't believe those. Listen, he says, don't mean that we're saved. Don't believe those enticing spirits. A real spirit of God, a real word of God, is the truth of God, which is a seed of God, will, here's an important word, produce God in your life.
Amen.
What kind of fruit? Be godly, saintly, holy. Amongst a lot of people, we find where emotions and so forth, there become tattlings and backbitings.
Amen.
Tattlings? You won't find, Brother Branham, I can't find anywhere else he uses that word. He talks about tattle, but he doesn't use that word tattlings, except here when he's talking about enticing spirits. We're not ignorant of Satan's devices. So what will he come in with to disrupt the body of Christ?
Amen.
Tattlings, backbitings.
Yeah.
You know, in the message, sometimes we have the tendency to be so up here in the ethereal.
Oh, yeah. Come on.
That we lose reality and we disconnect with real Christian life.
Yes.
Jesus was a real Christian man. He was the only Christian man, right? So listen to what Brother Branham says. There becomes a lot in the group where there's emotions and so forth. A lot of people, we find emotions. There become tattlings and backbitings and all kinds of ungodly things. I love this. I almost titled this Sunday school this. Brother, that's sulfuric acid in the church. Sulfuric acid in the church. It's demon power. Spirit of men and women who get among one another. You can be a one-man denomination. They get among one another and try to push off and say, this is not right, and that's not right, and that's not right. If you chase it down, 9 times out of 10, it's the very person making the stir that's not right. And then Brother Branham injects this in there. God hates discord among brethren.
Amen.
God hates discord among brethren. What is demon power? It's corrosive. You know, there can become, I don't care how us as believers, because we have even with the baptism of the Holy Ghost, but we have 5 senses. We have of the flesh. We have 5 senses of the spirit: memory, conscience, reason, imagination, affection. And we can ingest sulfuric acid with tempers and bitterness. Jelly too. That's my kids' way of saying it. You're just jelly. Jealousy.
Yes, amen.
We can ingest those kind of things and then spew them out. And Brother Branham says it's demon power working in the church, getting this one against this one, and this one has this little opinion and that. Remember, you're a nice little group, sweet little body of believers, but Satan won't let it stay that way. He's got devices he uses. He's got schemes. He's got designs. He's got tactics. And then Brother Branham says, God hates discord among brethren. He hates it. He hates it in the families. He hates it in husbands and wives. He hates discord. He hates discord among mothers and daughters and fathers and daughters and sons. Yeah. He hates it in the pulpit.
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
We should never project sulfuric acid. Preaching, I've seen preaching become corrosive. And that should never be a synonym we would use to describe the preaching of the Word of God. It should never be corrosive. Let me just simplify it for you. You'll never find Brother Branham preaching, which is our example, to tear down. You'll always find him building up. And true Christians never tear down, they build up. So the word preached should never tear. Now, if you're tearing Satan's kingdom down, that's one thing. But it should never tear down people.
Amen.
I'm just going to pause there for a moment. Let me take you to Standing in the Gap. Brother Branham's preaching, and he's about to leave the ministry. He's about to leave the field, and he has a Brother Roy Robertson has a dream of Brother Branham, and he says, you were at the head of the table, Brother Branham. He said, you were at the table, the Lord's Supper. And he said, and the light that you see in that picture came in the room and picked you up and carried you off the Lord's table. Now, Brother Branham's now removed from the table of the Lord. It was because he got a complex in his spirit against people. And Brother Branham says, then Brother Roy says, then I seen that same light come usher in, and he said, and it puts you at the head of the table, the head of the table. And Brother Roy says, and Brother Branham, you had been changed.
Amen.
And he says, it was odd to Brother Roy. Are you listening? He says, it was odd to Brother Roy, me being changed. Not like I was. Brother Branham takes a note, little sticky, and he writes it, and he sticks it on the pulpit, and he says, I want to come back to this later after I tell you the interpretation of that dream, Brother Roy, what it meant when it said you were changed, Brother Branham. You were gone, then you came back, but you were different. And Brother Branham goes through that entire message, Standing in the Gap, to tell you and confess transparently, I've lost my feeling for people. And he says, I called them Rickies and Rickettas. How many times you hear Brother Branham on the tape calling them Rickies and Rickettas? Brother Branham says, now the Lord showed me I ought not to do that.
Amen.
And he says, those are God's people.
Yeah.
And he's speaking not of message believers. He's speaking of denominational people and denominational systems. And he says, I called them Rickies and Rickettas. I ought not to have done that. He says, those might be God. He says, some of them are God's people, and they would serve the Lord if they knew what to serve. But they're so bound up by denominational creeds and ideas. And he said, they're just as much in prison as Israel was in Egypt when Moses came down to deliver them. And he says, but the Lord showed me I ought not to do that. I ought not to call them Rickies and Rickettas. So amazing. Sulfuric acid had gotten into Brother Branham, and his ministry had become corrosive to where he has said, he said, would you take a person and watch them blind if they were blind and couldn't see, and watch them walk over a cliff and not say anything to warn them, hey, blind man, you're about to walk over? And he said, you would never do that. It'd be so cruel, so indifferent. He says, well, brothers, to all my audience on tape and here, let me confess to you, that was just about the way I was. So if the prophet of God could lose his feeling for people, I think it would be fair to say that any believer here in a local body could get the wrong attitude towards one another.
Yes.
Satan's devices. Listen, and he says, amongst a lot of people become tattlings and bite men. That's demon power, spirit of men and women. Say, that's not right if you'll chase it down. And he says, God hates discord. I got to get through this. We're going to run out of time here. God hates discord. Be reverent. Be holy. Love God. Stand by him. And as long as you know your life is divvying up with the Bible, with purity, not as long as you have emotion, that's all right. But don't stop there. Make sure your life is divvying up with the Bible. Because if you have all the emotion in the world, but you have no love for your brother, your emotion profiteth you nothing.
Amen.
with purity of heart, purity. Listen, he says, as long as your life is divided up with the Bible, with purity of heart, purity of thought, love towards your brother, trying your best to upbuild the kingdom of God and doing those things, dressing right, living right, talking right, going right places, then you can have all the emotions you want to. And everybody will believe it. Listen, and why is that so many Christians find it so hard to live the Christian life? For in where, listen to what Brother Brandon says, for in where we have tried to have a Pentecostal free move of God, we have become to a place, a bunch of colonized cults almost. Amen. Just a place of confusion and discord. Colonized cults.
Amen. Ouch.
Ouch. He's speaking of our churches have just become a bunch of colonized cultish groups, little sects over here and a sect over here and a sect. Sectarianism was what Jesus hated. Amen. He says, colonized cults, almost just a bunch of place of... Now, why have they become colonized cults? What is colonized cults in confusion? Listen to what he says. What ought to happen here this afternoon? What ought to happen? There should be every Pentecostal church in the city jammed into this some big stadium out somewhere. And if it wasn't for little petty indifferences among the ministers and the people, it would be that way. So what are Satan's devices? Bring in little petty indifferences among ministry and the people. Let me just stop here for a moment and say that there's blessings to live streaming. There's also cursing and curses to live streaming. Live streaming has brought as many, and I would venture to say more, curses than blessings. If you were to put the totality and quantity and number, and I could list them. You might be right, I might be wrong. That's all right. The blessing and cursing of live streaming can be that we get the blessing could be that you can't come to church because of some legitimate reason why you can't gather, and so you're able to stream. That's wonderful. It can become a curse when it becomes a crutch or an excuse that Satan gives you for every reason to stay home and stream. Now, it's true, and all of us are guilty. All, A-L-L. This isn't about pointing fingers. All of us as a body can become guilty of this. Amen. Because we all are human and we all can tend to be lazy spiritually. So what happens also, Brother Matt, one of the curses of live streaming is that if we're not careful, we blur the lines and local churches lose their sovereignty. You lose the sovereignty of the local body and the local vision and the local burden, and then it becomes a global vision and a national vision and a national burden, and we have people who, preachers who are preaching to cameras, and they're not preaching to the people.
Yeah. Amen.
We get on church archives and watch other services, not to be blessed, but to find faults and to nitpick and to separate people and to draw circles and to build fences and build denominations and get little petty different indifferences because this brother's preaching this, and you lose this. I'm not talking about you have to preach. The pulpit is the place of God. The house of God is the house of correction, and judgment begins right here. Correction begins at the pulpit. But it's not me trying to correct another church hours away or down the street. Correction should be the local, the spirits that are infiltrating the local body.
Amen.
And those spirits, the Bible in the book of Revelation, you'll hear it over and over. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit's saying to the churches. So the Spirit's saying the same thing. I'm all for preaching against spirits of the Antichrist coming and infecting the body, the bride of Christ. That's all right. I'm not preaching against that. But it becomes corrosive when it becomes trying to correct the error of every pulpit and how they differ with you or disagree, and it becomes corrosive. And people ingest that corrosive spirit, and it brings division and divides people.
Amen.
Let me say this. We need to keep our head out of other brothers' church archives and back in the Word of God. We need to look away from the camera, I'm thankful for it, and to the eyes of the people that are here before me. Because that's who God has put me. The Bible says, I've put you to watch over their souls.
Amen.
Right. You say, Brother Matt, what are you preaching against? I'm preaching against any spirit that would come, not a brother, but a spirit that would come to try to tear down the body and not build up the body.
Amen.
Can you say amen? So let me say this. You're not preaching the spirit of Christ. You're not preaching the spirit of the messenger. You're not preaching the message when you're preaching or even not in a pulpit. But when your life is sowing discord amongst people, you're not preaching the message. When you're preaching your soapbox, you're not preaching the message. Amen. When you're preaching your pet peeve, you're not preaching the spirit of Christ. Remember what Brother Branham says here. They get little petty indifferences. Listen to what he says. Because then this is, what is the Holy Ghost? Now, this is amazing because this is how Brother Branham approached the subject of differences. Because everybody has their differences and every church has their own beliefs. And if you don't, you're not a church. That's a direct quote. Listen how Brother Branham dealt with special meetings when he would go to preach for another brother or another church. Because in these meetings like this, on the evangelistic type, we have people from different denomination of churches, which has been taught in their own sphere of belief, each one. And that's all right. I have never wanted to be guilty of sowing discord among brethren. And out in the meetings, I just preach on the great evangelical truths of the scripture, on what brethren who sponsor my meeting believe in. But in the tabernacle here, I want to speak on what we believe. Yes. Therefore, if you do not understand it, I would be very happy to have a little letter or note from you to ask me a question on why that we believe it thus. And I would be glad to try to explain it. So how did Brother Branham deal with this, with differences? He would never go in. He would preach at his church what he believed. But when he preached at another brother's church or another meeting, he stuck with the things we could all agree on, and he didn't try. And it wasn't that he didn't preach the word or he didn't preach the full counsel of the word. You can preach the issues that face the body without preaching the conflicts or the wars between people and churches. Right? So he says, I go into meetings and I don't preach. I just stick with the evangelical truths of the Bible. And he says, I would never be. Listen to this. He says, you know, every church, if you don't have a doctrine, you're not a church. You've got to have something that you stand on, some principles that you're holding up. And regardless of what a person's affiliation or denomination might be, if that person is born of the Spirit of God, that's my brother or my sister. Regardless, listen, we might differ in other things as far as east from the west, but we're still brothers. And I would not do nothing but try to help that brother for a closer walk to Christ. And I believe any real, true Christian would do the same. Identify with Christ. I've never tried to separate or sow discord among brethren. Can we agree?
Amen.
This was the spirit of the messenger. I've never tried to. Was Brother Branham just a jellyfish and he just preached what everybody wanted? You've not heard the message if you believe that. Did Brother Branham never preach against spirits? Did he never preach against carnality? Did he never preach against emotionalism or intellectualism, frolic, and funeral? Remember that quote? Brother Branham said, some people make church a funeral. Some people make it a frolic. And he says, it's not neither. It's a feast. The bride goes right down the middle. Did Brother Branham preach? Did he just not preach against anything? No, he did, but he kept the spirit of Christ. His heart was in the right place. His focus was not to tear down.